last thing I want to do in this lecture, before well, actually the penultimate thing before also talking about multiple linear regression for a really short time, is the assumptions we're doing here. And when we do linear regression, we make a set of assumptions that should be satisfied for the regression results to be valid. And this set of assumptions can be conveniently remembered with the word line. And the assumptions we're having is linearity of response, independence of residuals, normality of residuals, and equivariance. And all these assumptions naturally follow from the structure of our linear model, which I told you in the very beginning, that where our residuals here are normally distributed with a mean zero, such that, well, that we have a linear model, so we have this beta, we only have the slope and the intercept, so this must be linear. The residuals are independent, so they are all normally distributed. They are normally distributed, and they all have this equivariance, which does not depend on the x position. Okay, so this implies, these assumptions implies that after removing the data explained by our linear model, only white noise, Gaussianly distributed noise, should be left. And now we're looking at a bunch of visual checks to actually verify these assumptions. So, first of all, the linearity of response. And a plot helps us to check for many assumptions in this residual plot. So let's simply plot the residuals against the predictor variable and draw a horizontal line at zero to indicate our expected mean. Right, so we remember the residuals is the difference between the predicted and the observed values. And we say that our response is linear, that if our response is linear, then the residual should be centered around zero. So the structure is gone and only noise is left. So let's do that here. And now, does this look normally distributed? Well, I would say it does. So the residual plot does indicate a linear response. Now for all of these examples, for all of these assumptions, I'm going to give you an example where it does not hold. So let me show you this example where we have, now we create a cube data. Okay, so we don't have a linear model here, but we should have a cubic model here. And now if we look at the residuals, so first of all, this here is our fit, and our fit does explain much of the variance here. So it explains roughly half of the variance here in the data, which is a bit, but obviously not as much as the 97% we had earlier. Now, if we look at the residual plots, this is what we see. And these residuals don't look like here, though. So we don't see, so the response is apparently not linear. Here, they are all above it. And then they're all below in between here, with these being even far higher. So we see that the cubic model explains a lot of the variance, but does not capture the structure of our actual data. So if we see a residual plot like this, it means that our model did not capture enough, and the structure, apparently, of the underlying structure of the data is not linear. Next up, the independence of residuals, which says that there should be no relation between current and previous residuals. And we already saw this here. So by using this residual, I can predict these residuals. So using the ones before here, I can predict that the ones here are probably below that. So if residuals are independent, then I cannot guess with more than chance what the next one is going to be given the previous ones. Okay, so this was already visible here, but it's even more visible in, for example, sinusoidal curves here. So let's make sinusoidal data, and let's fit a linear model on top of that. And we see that R squared 64, so we explain already 64% of variance. This is quite a bit. But if we now look at the residuals, we see that they obviously still have some kind of structure. And we can predict, using these two points, we can predict that the next one is probably going to be here. So if we see a residual plot like this, even though we explained a lot of variants, there's still a lot of structure left in our data, and this was not a good fit. And then the third one, normality of residuals. And to check if our residuals actually follow a normal distribution, we can do two things. First, we can make a histogram of the residuals and then put the theoretical normal distribution on top to see if these distributions match up. We can do it like this, so we have a histogram of our residuals here, and on top of that, scaling it correctly, we put the theoretical normal distribution, and then we see this kind of matches up. But there's a better way to show this, and this is the so-called QQ plot. A QQ plot is a quantile-quantile plot, which is a more precise way of checking if the empirical distribution follows a normal distribution. And this does that by plotting the quantiles of the empirical distribution against the quantiles of the theoretical distribution. So at the 1% quantile of the theoretical distribution, what is how much of the data is here at the theoretical, at the empirical distribution, and at the 50% quantile, how much of the data is there before that and after that, and at the 100% quantile, and so on and so on. Okay, so if the two distributions match, then the points should form a straight line, because no matter if we're at the beginning or at the end of our distribution, the quantile of how many samples of our actual distribution are match up to the theoretical distribution should be roughly the same. Okay, if you want to know more about the QQ plot, you can also visit this link. But let's look at it. In the stats models package, there is a function for the QQ plot. And on this QQ plot, we want to plot the residuals. And also we want a line at 45 degrees because we want a standard normal distribution here. And the line should be at 45 degrees. And we see that this here is mostly a straight line except for outliers at the beginning and the end. This, for example, here being one outlier. This is something which is still rather fine. So we see on this QQ plot, this is pretty much a straight line. Okay, so when pairing up the quantiles of a distribution to the pendant of the theoretical one, making the scatter plot here with the theoretical and the sample quantiles, this is almost a straight line, so this is what we want. Okay. An example of where the normality does not hold, I have also shown you before, and that is the cube fit here. And if we look at the QQ plot for the residuals of a cube fit, we see this here is apparently not a straight line. So they are also, so the cubed one does not only violate our assumption of linearity, but also of normality of response according to the QQ plot. And then the last one is equivariance, homoscedasticity, that can also be evaluated using the residual plot. Let's create an example which does not have equivariance manually. So we simply have so we simply increase the scale for our model here. So the first 25 samples have a scale of 1, then 2, then 4, then 8, such that the distribution of normality of the distribution, the width of a normal distribution here becomes wider towards the end. And now if we make our least squares fit, this here is the residuals, and we can see rather obvious that these here are closer to zero, more close centered around zero than these ones. So the variance is higher here, and thus the equivariance constraint would be not met here. Okay, now check as one exercise, check the assumptions of the linear regression on the TIPS dataset. To answer the question if it was right to use linear regression on this dataset like we did before. So for this, we look at these two plots. This is the first one, and we can also look at the QQ plot. And we see, well, this doesn't look like equal variance, so the variance does seem, so here the points seem to be closer than here, and also the QQ plot here, this is a line, yes, but it does not follow the 45 degrees which we wanted it. So what we see here, if we look at this plot, is that as the total bill increases, so does the variance. So this kind of makes sense, right? If you give more, if you pay more, then the variance of your tip raises. This is why bootstrapping to get the standard error and confidence interval didn't return the same result than stats models, because stats models computes them analytically, assuming that the assumptions hold. And thus, what stats models calculated was probably off, and those bootstrapping results are the ones we should believe more, because this bootstrapping does not have the assumptions that stats models did when it did the analytics.